Oh,
Hello,
brother.
I think we're live. I see us counting down.
I could. I hope. I guess we are live.
Yeah.
StreamYard's giving me all these messages saying, edit. Sorry, we can't go live. So I think it's one of our streams didn't work today, but that's okay. I was trying the LinkedIn stream too, and we'll have to see what happens with that. But anyway, hi, Jen Wilson and Amy Vetter here for our leadership lunch chat. I didn't go back and see how many weeks we've been doing this now, Amy, but it's got to be like 12.
Yeah. Like that. I was looking at that last week when I was posting the video
and
after.
So I think it's one of our streams didn't work today, but that's okay. That's interesting. Hello. Hi. Well, we play our stream. So anyway, we usually get together on Fridays and process our week and process what's happening in the profession. And one of the things I mentioned to Amy that I was hoping that we could talk a little bit about today is really like post busy season. You just finished the world's longest busy season for those who have tax practices, you've got about 10 to 12 weeks of proactive potential between here and 1/1/21, where you start your spring busy season. So we thought we'd talk a little bit about ideas related to proactive things you could be doing to really, you know, focus your firm post spring busy season and in the midst of the pandemic. And Amy, I don't know if you want to start off or how you'd like to go today, but normally I would just hand it to you and you get going and we'll see what we can find in terms of ideas for proactivity.
Yeah, so I would definitely say we've heard a few issues over and over again. One of those being mental health. And it's a big issue for everyone right now, just trying to overcome what they've overcome. And as we're in the rat race and trying to keep up on the hamster wheel, and busy season went all the way through July 15th, we didn't get the time off and we don't have much of a breather before moving into the next extension period, which is September 15th, October 15th, and so forth. I think it's really important to not only understand what you're feeling yourself, but what the people around you are feeling too, and be really honest about it. Not try to put the walls up, the masks on, try to feel something you're not. I mean, I think before we got on, we were talking about how we feel. And I was saying I have a different score internally than externally. And I think it's important that we share that with the people that we work with, that we care about, and that we're having those honest conversations.
I agree. I had a hilarious conversation with a managing partner yesterday. We were talking, he had kind of a surprise happen to him, where one of his really close and important employees suddenly just came in and said, "Man, I am overwhelmed and unhappy." And he really didn't have any signals. You know, he didn't feel like he had any signals. And we talked about how critical it is that we ask our people, you know, how are you doing? And, I told him some questions that I like to ask, like, what's working? What's not working? How come? How can I help? Sometimes your people think, you can't help me. You look overwhelmed too. I'm not going to ask you. And so we have to open up the space and say, you know, don't look at how I'm doing. I want to know how you're doing and what I can do to help you. So that's one thought. The other thing, though, is that we were laughing, this managing partner and I, about this idea that, like, you know, when I started out in the world of work, you weren't supposed to bring your whole self to work. You were supposed to, like, fake it. You were supposed to pretend like you had no kids, no husband or wife. You know, like if you made a personal phone call, you snuck out onto the, you know.
But it wasn't even just that. It was how you dressed. Like it had to be navy suits and a skirt. Like for women, you weren't allowed to wear pants. You had to wear skirts to your knees. Like,
oh, yeah.
The whole thing.
Nylons and pumps, closed-toe shoes and all that. Well, but my point is that, like, there was some kind of weird barrier to being authentic and real in the workplace. Mm-hmm. And that was considered professional. You were right. Unprofessional if you were authentic and real. And
right.
So now, you know, I think we want to be way more authentic and real right now with our people and figure out where they are and help them plan and plot time off for the rest of this year and really focus on strategies to get healthy and be sure everybody's doing what they need to do. And that requires an authentic conversation. I like to say, you know, I want you to bring your whole self to work, but I don't want you to bring a moving truck of all your problems every day, unless those problems are things we can solve together. You know, you've got to be careful about persistent complaints that you're not working on.
Yeah.
So that's not, I think, what we're trying to invite. We're trying to invite authentic, like, this isn't working for me. I mean, I'm not able to quit working. You're emailing me at 8 p.m. I feel like I have to be around. I don't stop and eat dinner. That kind of stuff needs to be discussed and you have to open up the space for it. So anyway, I just thought it was funny, this idea that in the past it was like, how are you? I'm fine. Things are good. You know, what about you? Fine. Okay. Let's get to business. You know,
exactly.
The inauthenticity of that. If the pandemic's done nothing else, it certainly stripped all of us of the, you know, the need to fake it, I guess.
Well, and I also think just people working remote, I mean, I know it's been interesting for me, like people you're used to, I mean, I've always worked remote, you've always worked remote, but when we've done remote meetings, most people are in the office. And then now when you're doing remote meetings, you're seeing their home, you're seeing kids walk by or cats walking by a camera or whatever that is. And you actually start learning more about people because of it. And
So
there's positive around it as well, where it doesn't have to be so buttoned up either, that you can embrace it and just be like, this is the crap I got going on right now. So there's nothing I can do about this. The dogs are going to bark, you know, or whatever. And everybody's in the same boat. And so it's that feeling of just, when you come back to authenticity, transparency, but acceptance of where we're at and how people are feeling. And when we let that stress go of trying to keep a boundary or not a boundary, but a goal of the way it was in the office, then that's putting too much pressure on everyone. So I would say that is one area that I think as a leader right now, we need to open up and make sure we're really honest how we're feeling and others. But I know you have a couple other experiences that have happened this week with partners too, where you've seen.
Yeah, well, as we think about proactive strategies for the next 10 to 12 weeks, there's a couple of thoughts that I have. And one is, we've talked about this a little bit, disruption. We've been predicting this disruption, that it would come, and that would have come in the form of next gen clients and their desire for more digital service. It would come in the form of next gen talent and their lack of tolerance for all kinds of things. You know, their desire to have a better workplace, a better world, if you will, and technology vendors coming in and disintermediating. So we've been saying that's coming. The virus turns out to be this incredible dress rehearsal for this disruption. It is a, you know, world-class disruption from an unexpected source. But what it's forced is it's forced us all to move to a new place technologically, digitally, remote work, acceptance of diverse viewpoints, work styles, work hours, you know, all of that. And I have been begging, and I mean begging, firm leaders in the last couple of weeks as we're doing strategic planning and refocusing their firms on getting kind of out of crisis mode and into strategic mode and reaffirming or changing their strategic priorities because of the pandemic. I've been begging them, please do not go back to the office and go backward and lose this momentum you have on digital client service and digital workforce management and the idea of going borderless and not caring about where people work or where our clients live. Don't go backward. You already got thrust forward. So now take that and go forward before the disruption we were predicting comes.
Well, and to add to that, what's happened right now is foundational technology. This is not digital transformation. No. And I just want to define
clearly.
Digital transformation takes time, takes planning, takes thought and purpose. And putting Zoom in place is a step, but it is not the full technology transformation in order to really propel your business into the future. And so I think there's people right now that are like, well, we did it. We're remote, you know, and so forth. And that's a step. So that is something that needed to happen years ago, and this kind of forced it. So that's a positive thing. But what really needs to happen right now is the pause and the planning of what's worked, what doesn't work, and who do we want to be now? Now that we have experienced this, now that our staff is remote and we don't have borders, what's the dream, right? Like, this gives us that opportunity of possibility that can open our minds with innovation that maybe we haven't had that opening before and we're forced to that opening. But if we keep rushing forward with the work and saying, we're all remote, so we're good, let's just keep moving with how we're moving, you're still not grasping the opportunity of digital transformation. And digital transformation is truly looking at who do you want to serve, what makes you excited when you get up in the morning to do the work that you do, and then what technology is going to enable you to get there, what services do you want to offer, and what business processes will you need to change. So don't miss this opportunity to stop and pause before we get into the next busy season.
For sure. And I mean, I love that you said, this isn't it, you know, this isn't it. There are a lot of firms that, unfortunately, they are still stuck in foundational. They don't have everything paperless. They don't have scanners in the hands of their people. You know, I had one client say, hey, we're going to buy scanners for all of our clients, and we'll have somebody go out and install them in masks, you know? And I was like, no, you know, wait, you know, could we use you know, scanner app on the cell phone, you know, show them that at first so that they could just get, you know, the littlest bit of scanning going, and then let them commit to the digital strategy on their side. Yes, you can help them. And yes, if you're doing IT consulting, I guess, and providing hardware to clients, sure, go do that. But I still think there's a lot of foundational work that's part of that vision for some firms. For other firms, they had a lot of the pieces in place already, and they're ready to do that vision planning you talked about. And you know, you said, who do we want to be? And I like to also ask, what are we committed to? Like, what are we committed to do now? What are we committed to be now? And I do think that that's really critical for us to have folks stop and ask now. Circle your wagons with your leadership team and say, okay, now we've done crisis management for 14 or 15 weeks or 18 weeks or whatever the number is. Now let's do strategic management for the next X weeks that we have. And I, by my calculation, if you take holiday weeks out, and you take the 2 weeks before September 15th and October 15th out, you got about 10, 11 weeks left of proactive work. So you need to be doing your planning here in the next 2 weeks or 3 weeks. And of course, you're not going to implement a long range digital transformation strategy in 10 weeks. But to start really looking at where are we trying to go, so you don't backpedal or take steps backward in the next 10 to 12 weeks. Mm-hmm. And a lot of firms, when I've been listening to their reopening strategy, what it really is just get everybody back to the office and let's get back to business as usual. Yeah, we'll have masks on. And that makes me feel heartbroken because we lose all of the opportunity to change, you know, to maintain the leap we took and make another leap forward. And firms that get that will really transform and have a competitive advantage, I think.
And when we do those things ourselves, we become better advisors to our clients. So even if we have to think about it in a way of a non-selfish way of doing this, when we test it on ourselves, when we learn these new processes, we learn new technology, we learn what we, how to plan, how to vision plan, how to build out. And when you're talking about those lulls, that's part of the plan, right? It's like, now I know in my break between October 15th and next February, this is what I'm going to work on. So I'm putting my vision plan in now, knowing that that will get me set and ready for my next lull to start planning. The other thing I would say with that is don't feel like you have to do it all alone. That there are consultants like us and consultants all over that specialize in different areas that you need help with. And so sometimes these things can be insurmountable because they're new to you. You've never experienced them before. But the good thing is there's people out there that do this every single day and you know, and can give you best practices and the shortcuts. So don't feel like you're alone in this process. And it is important that when you're putting it together, that you are figuring out where the time investment is, who, what, and where, and then what other money investment do you have to make outside of your business as well to make sure that you can take your plan to close.
Definitely. The other thing that you know, we've been trying to have firms look at is what is our remote or blended work strategy if we're going to have a blended workforce and we're committed to that going forward. Some in the office, lot remote, whether working from home or clients or wherever. And then also, you know, so that's one possible strategic area to focus and enable. The other is digital client service. And that is not the same roadmap for every service line. It's not one size fits all service lines. You have to create the vision by service line of what that digital client service looks like, or enhanced client experience, including a lot of digital elements, if you want to think of it that way.
Right.
How do we deliver services and audit more digitally, more remotely, more blended workforce, more blended client workforce? Because, you know, it's not just us trying to selfishly manage our remote people. Our clients are going to have way more remote people. I've been reading CFO Magazine, and it's funny, every once in a while I catch a, you know, somebody saying, don't let your people all work remotely. You know, they're all paranoid. You know, not CFO Magazine, but some of the article authors, you know, like, but wait a minute, don't let this remote runaway train get you, you know? And I'm like, too late. You know what I mean? Like, come on guys, finance people can work remotely 100%. So, but you know, how can we manage that client service delivery process and their experience by service line? And I think each of those is a kind of a mini strategic plan that needs to be implemented, and probably not all at once. So again, it's a planning and prioritization process. And like Amy said, there's lots of folks that have lots of experience that can help.
Yeah. And I think it's such an important point you bring up, is that you're bringing your clients into the testing process. So when, and this can mean a public accounting firm or a business, right? Like, it doesn't, your customers can be internal customers, departments you serve, other people within a company you serve, or someone externally. But when you are testing new technology or new ways of doing business, it's important to be getting their feedback along the way. And one of the things that I always say to people that are especially doing it with external clients is to say, look, I'm not going to charge you for this. This is part of my research, and I need to see how this feels to you, what you like about it, what you don't like about it. And so you want to do it with your friendly clients that you don't feel like you feel stupid around them. Like, if you're not perfect at what you're doing yet, that you're learning it with them, and they can give you feedback as you're going with it. But the good part about doing it that way is that once you finish and you start implementing this, you already have your marketing copy. Yes. You've got your testimonials. They've already told you what they like about this experience. And that will help you with selling it going forward, because you're already telling them, this is the kind of information you're going to get when you work with me. This is the kind of experience that's going to be different than any other person that you've worked with before. And you've got the kind of value add that isn't something that someone can price shop, right? Because they're getting the experience that they want.
Yes. And I agree with everything you said, except for I think we could still charge the clients. We just wouldn't charge them our normal rates. well, seriously, because they'll get value too. And I think
saying really super good your normal engagement, but when you're running parallel with a new thing, you know, you don't charge for that.
Oh, right. The secondary.
You're still charging, you're keeping them on whatever you were doing before.
Yes, I just know our low pricing self-esteem CPA community. Need to help remember, yes, your time has value. Please bill, please bill. So Amy, we are at time, slightly over, which is no surprise to me.
Yeah.
And about 1/60th into our list of ideas that we had for today. So we'll just return next Friday and pick up maybe where we left off, or who knows, maybe our whole agenda will be disrupted by something new and emerging. And you guys can disrupt us by sending ideas to us or posting in social when you see this this broadcast. Please send us ideas for what you want to talk about. And we welcome you to the stream too. You're welcome to come in here and participate with us. So anyway, we really enjoyed today again and hope you guys have a great end of July and entry into August. And we'll see you in August.
Have a great weekend.
Hey.